coming to the dislocations of upper limb, particularly the very common dislocation is shoulder joint dislocation. As you know, it's a some kind of a ball and socket joint. The head of the humerus will be articulating with the glenoid cavity here, and shoulder joint has got so many movements like abduction, adduction, internal rotation, external rotation, forward flexion, backward flexion or extension. So, and all these things put together, sometimes my patient can do complete rotation in 360 degrees. This is known as circumduction. So, taking into consideration the wide range of mobility that's available here, this is going to be more prone for dislocation. Especially, as you know, the glenoid cavity is not that big as the acetabular cavity in the hip. And similarly, the capsule is not very strong in particular areas like hip joint capsules, because this is a non-weight bearing joint. That's why probably the ligaments are not that strong when compared to the hip joints. So naturally, when in a particular position, the head of the humerus is just in contact with the capsule, whenever there's a force, it may push it out. So that's why it's more common to have dislocation of the shoulder when compared to all other joints. Here, once again, in shoulder dislocation, there are different varieties of dislocations: anterior, posterior, then inferior, and one more thing is there known as luxio, that is, comes down along the axilla. So the fourth one is a very, very uncommon thing. It's known as luxatio erecta, that is, the joint goes below inferiorly and the shoulder remains like that. It will come in the longitudinal direction like this. It's a very, very rare dislocation. Hardly about 1% of the dislocations of the shoulder, it comes among about 1%, and very, very rare. But by far the commonest things are anterior, posterior and inferior. Here 95% will be anterior. Again, in anterior dislocation, depending upon where the head is placed after dislocation, we call it as subclavicular, that is, head of the humerus goes below the clavicle. That's why we call it as subclavicular. Or if it is just below the coracoid, we call it as subcoracoid. Third is subglenoid. Among these things, again, the most common is subcoracoid dislocation. That is, this head of the humerus may get dislocated and seen below the clavicle. Then, because it's below clavicle, we call it a subclavicular or subcoracoid. This is the coracoid, and the head of the humerus gets displaced and lies here below. Or sometimes it will be just below the glenoid cavity here. We call it as subglenoid dislocation. Here, the mechanism of injury is most commonly it is fall on outstretched hand like this. When the longitudinal force is there, as the body comes forwards like this, the head of the humerus pierces the capsule and comes out of the glenoid cavity. And posterior dislocation is common. It's also quite a rare thing. It occurs due to direct injury in front. Entire head of the humerus is pushed backwards, and it is more of a subluxation than complete dislocation. So by far the commonest is the subcoracoid type of anterior dislocation. How can you make out that there is a dislocation? As the patient walks in, he supports the dislocated hand with the other hand like this. You can see somebody with agonizing pain, with all the pain and holding like that and moving, you are almost certain that the fellow has got a dislocation of the shoulder. So first thing is the pain in the shoulder and inability to move the shoulder or the upper limb. And the upper limb is always protected or supported by the hand, opposite hand. This is a very, very common. Actually, the patient walks in like this, moving in this direction, and this itself should indicate that the fellow has got a dislocation. Then what are the other symptoms? There are several symptoms or signs that are described by different people, but the most important thing is, you see below, normally we can easily feel the rounded head of the humerus below and away from the acromion. In that area where there should be fullness, there will be a depression. because the head of the femoris is not in the correct position. Near the deltoid, there is a depression. And then second one is patient will not be able to touch the opposite shoulder because he can't do any internal rotation. Third one is if you look at the axillary region, it appears as if when compared to the normal axilla, this circumference or the girth of the axilla will be more on the affected side. One more thing is, if you keep a straight roller from the epicondyle to the acromion, it's not possible because the deltoid muscle and the head of the humerus, they will prevent the straight roller touching both epicondyle as well as the tip of the acromion at the same time. Here, the roller test, because the head of the humerus is moved inside or downwards, then we will be able to keep a straight roller touching the lateral epicondyle and the tip of the acromion. So this is another test that is done. And the most important thing is inability to do internal rotation reaching the opposite shoulder. This is one of the important signs because at the time of reduction, if one can put the hand into the opposite shoulder, that means your reduction is good enough. So then if you have a suspicion of a dislocation, it's not very, very difficult to diagnose a case of shoulder dislocation. The minute patient walks into the room, you can make out that the fellow has got a dislocation. Of course, once you take an x-ray, it's very easy to make out. The glenoid cavity will be empty. The head is seen in a different position, abnormal position. As I mentioned in the classification, it could be below the coracoid process or below the glenoid or below the clavicle. Then what is that you have got to do? Better, because it's a very, very painful condition. Patient can't bear with it. And even if there is, the patient has come with full stomach also, if you see the patient immediately after the injury or within an hour or two, the spasm of the muscles will not be there much. So we can easily reduce that under heavy sedation or short tightening anesthetic, general anesthetics, after taking the necessary precautions. But sometimes if you make the patient wait for nearly 6 hours, for 6 hours you'll have to sedate the patient. If the patient is heavily built and muscular, may require a muscle relaxant. So a very heavy patient, if about more than a couple of hours time is there between the incident and patient presenting to us, better always to do under anesthesia. This manipulated reduction is done according to a particular type of maneuver, one known as Cox method. There are two methods. Fresh cases, we can do that. And second thing is Hippocrates method, in which you have got to do the reduction by placing the patient on the floor and pushing with our heel into the axilla and forcibly pulling the upper limb. So it looks very horrible to look at it. You have got to put the patient after anesthesia, and this usually is necessary only after 3 to, if the patient, there's an interval of more nearly 2 to 3 weeks, the normal maneuver will not be able to manage. So these patients may require this Hippocrates method of management. So, but I use the combination of both, and my maneuver is very, very simple, and it doesn't require too much of maneuvers and too much of assistance from the other people. Now I'll talk about the first method of normal and routine method that's used for reduction of the shoulder is make the patient lie down. So once the patient is anesthetized, you've got to take a towel and encircle it into the axillary region, and the assistant at the head of the table, near the head of the patient, will be pulling it. This is known as traction. As this is being done, suppose it's my somebody's axilla is like that, what I have got to do is gradually pull it and do external rotation. And pull it down. Or as the traction is going on, I'll be applying traction in this opposite direction, straight like this. As the traction is being continued, flex the elbow and bring the elbow towards the umbilicus and then do internal rotation. So traction, counter-traction, and then move the elbow towards the umbilicus, second step, and do internal rotation, keep the hand on the opposite shoulder. While you are doing the second maneuver, suddenly the head of the humerus goes into the glenoid cavity, and the patient, and actually we can feel the reduction with this click. So once that is there, if the reduction is good, we can easily put the hand on the opposite shoulder. is a very easy technique. This is the standard technique everybody uses. But second is, so second technique, my technique is very simple. As the person, of course, imagine the patient lying down, the person is vertically standing now. But here, as what I do is, usually I ask some assistant to go on giving pressure in the abducted position, 90 degree shoulder position, radial pressure. As the person is giving the traction there, adjust with the thumb, push it inwards. So easily within 10 seconds, you can have it. Instead of having this towel around the axilla, while somebody pushing it and somebody pulling, at the same time, you have to do all the maneuvers yourself. It's very difficult. Because after experience, you can make it easy. But one day, suddenly, when I discovered about nearly 20 years ago, as somebody was trying to pull it in the wrong position, suddenly, forgetting about everything, suddenly I had a third sound that shows reduction. Then I was wondering how it happened. Then I realized by just keeping it in abduction pulling with some thumb, you know, under anesthesia, the muscles are relaxed. Just you can push it, it goes in without any difficulty. This is my maneuver from last 15, 20 years. I'm doing this. It hardly takes about, sometimes people will be, anesthesia will be laughing at me. Sir, I didn't even finish giving the injection, your reduction is over. So this also is another thing, and it doesn't require much of somebody to a proper trained assistant to give you traction and all that. So whatever it is, finally, after reduction, you always keep the shoulder, hand on the opposite shoulder and immobilize this with strapping. Apply strapping or bandage. This must be kept for 3 weeks minimum. I repeat, 3 weeks minimum of immobilization is very necessary. Or of late, what are known as shoulder immobilizers are available. They are ready-made. They can be applied and patient. Most important thing is, in this, we should not allow external rotation and abduction. So post reduction, most important thing is, patient should not do any abduction or external rotation. If this happens, there's a tendency for the shoulder to get re-dislocated. So we don't want that kind of re-dislocation. So if you don't want that to happen, you immobilize the hand in this position, see that the patient doesn't do any abduction and external rotation. This is the most important part, because very often the pain subsides within a few minutes. Patient comes to us with agonizing pain, holding the opposite with the opposite hand and all that, he'll be literally shouting. And a person like that, with this just a small maneuver, he gets very good pain relief. And once the anesthesia is over, patient will not have any pain. When you keep it for 3 weeks, lot of patients, they want to go back to their work and they say, we have removed because they did not have any more pain after a few days. So this is a very dangerous thing, because if this happens, especially, you know, according to statistics, people at younger age, say up to 30, 35 years, they have a tendency for recurrent dislocation, because the, I have already mentioned at the time of mechanism of dislocation, this capsule, it goes on moving, it pierces the capsule and comes out and goes back. You must give enough time for the capsule to heal. That's number one. A tear in the capsule may be there, that may take a little time to heal. And second important thing, after the advent of MRI, previously also it's known, but still with the availability of MRI, then contrast MRI and all that, we'll be able to make out detachment of the, there is a glenoidal labrum, small lip-like thing. Suppose this is the glenoid, there's an extra lip, this is known as labrum. This glenoid labrum will get detached, and because of that, this becomes, this is the glenoid, this kind of labrum which is there, which deepens the glenoid, this gets detached. And that's why, in addition to capsular tear, this also may be one of the factors for what is known as recurrent dislocations. So now perhaps this we feel is the commonest cause for recurrent dislocation. Another thing is the head of the humerus. Some people have a posterior lateral defect here. And then because of this defect, like in some lunar eclipse or something like that, it will be like this. This is one more cause for recurrent dislocation. So please immobilize the shoulder for at least 3 weeks, because I'm not going to talk much about these things, because there's another subject entirely by itself known as recurrent dislocation. We talk about it. It's a very, very common problem nowadays. So we'll talk about it later. But remember, that detachment of the glenoid labrum, and this is known as Bancott's lesion. This defect is known as Hill-Sachs lesion. So the post manipulation patient requires minimum of 3 to 4 weeks of rest before you mobilize the shoulder. In case of some dislocations, we have what is known as fracture dislocation. In fracture dislocation, this greater tuberosity get broken and seen separately, whereas the head of the humerus will be somewhere here in the partly broken here. Fortunate thing about this kind of fracture dislocation is once we reduce the fracture, luckily the fracture falls into position, it looks like a undisplaced fracture of the greater tuberosity. So it doesn't require anything special except keeping the elbow in immobilized position for about 3 weeks. If we feel the displacement a little too much, then we can fix it up with a screw like this. So this is rarely needed unless this is broken into 2 or 3 bits and all that, that's a different kind of a fracture. But usually a small bit of greater tuberosity will get broken and get separated. Once you reduce, this gets into position. So there's nothing special we have got to do for these things.